Watch. Who?
Hello.
And welcome to Two Watch Who, a Doctor Who podcast. I'm Mark.
I'm Sarah.
And I'm a Doctor Who fan.
And I'm new to watching Who.
Watching for the very first time.
Very first time.
And recess is over. Court is back in session. For a third time.
For the third time, we're back in court.
I hope you're all rested. Sugar Daddy Valliard is ready for his his next section. Just to recap, we lost Perry last week. One thing I forgot to say about that, you know, Perry was in her bald cap thing.
Yeah.
She reminds me of, have you seen...
There we go.
Poot Lovato. I can't believe I forgot this last week. I have to tell you this now. So, you know Demi Lovato?
Yes.
Okay, so ages ago, she was at a premiere and like a fan like took a picture of her on their phone and the lighting was really bad and she's smiling into the camera and it looks like she looks like Perry. She looks like she hasn't got any hair.
Right.
The lighting's just like... And it was slightly modified, but not very much. It turned into like a massive meme. And someone said, it's Poot Lovato, Demi Lovato's long-lost sister. This was a photo taken the first time she went out into daytime because she was shut in a basement for like these years.
Right, and
it became this huge thing as Poot Lovato. Even like Demi Lovato ended up like sharing it. And fans were writing stories all about Poot, this long-lost sister and everything. Anyway, I'll have to send you a picture, but it looks exactly like Perry in Mind Warp. Exactly like that. So I just had to share that bit of evidence with everybody.
Okay. The trial.
Or should we just go straight into it?
I think we have to, because this sort of goes straight into it. There's no real... In fact, what I will say this, what I really liked about the start of this was the crossover of the Doctor talking trial talk with us going into the story. You know, my criticism last time was that they almost felt like separate stories. This made it feel merged as one a little bit. It made it feel like it's all part of the story rather than here's some trial stuff. Now we're watching an episode. Because you had the voiceover at the start where he's explaining stuff that's been going, what's going on, and like setting the scene. But that's the court thing, but it's setting the scene into what we're about to see.
I think there's less court scenes throughout this one. Well, it felt like it. There was less interruptions.
There were less interruptions. The interruptions were more like start and end. There was a few, but it flowed better. There was a much more of a flow to it rather... Like, it felt relevant.
Well, it's the Doctor's part of the trial this time, giving evidence from the future.
Yeah, that was cool.
Which means we suddenly meet Mel. Were you expecting anything like this?
I was not expecting that at all. Again, though, it was a really cool sort of like entrance into it. Like, we're in the future. This person we haven't met, they are very comfortable with each other. He's very comfortable. And we are like, it was a really cool way of doing it.
Well, it's very different. We haven't had that. And because usually the new companion would be the side character for their first story, and we...
There's no
like,
side character in here. She is in it.
Carrot juice!
It'll do you good. Honestly, carrots are full of vitamin A.
She is straight in it. Yeah. Okay, well, what do you think of Mel? I have to know what you think.
It's interesting, because she's already so established, like their relationship is established, there's no explaining anything, there's no... In fact, she knows just as much as, like, a companion that's been there a year. It's quite an interesting sort of dynamic to like get into. And at times it felt a touch annoying. You almost like, you grow with a character. Do you know what I mean? You grow with them. I always say the companion is us. The companion is the viewer. To some extent, by this point, with that argument, you could argue, well, we all know how it all works. So for someone to just be diving straight in. But we also need to grow with them. And we want to learn with them and look with them. But I loved her energy. She has top-notch screams. Her screams are very good. Like, it was fun. But you don't know her. Where has she come from? It opens up many questions.
Okay, yeah. Well, at the time, I don't think it was a popular choice to have Bonnie Langford as the new companion. I think, again, we're going into stunt casting with the producer, probably hoping that she'd be in his pantos.
Well, I was thinking it was interesting because, last story was Brian Blessed. We're talking, pretty well-known names at this point. Like, even now, we know these names of these people. Bonnie Langford, we know Bonnie, Brian Blessed. They're names that we know still. And they've got, good parts. It's interesting.
The criticism was that, Mel was not liked, and for a very long time. It's weird to see her there, knowing that she's going to be with Shuti Gatwa in the new series. It's so weird, isn't it? And it was a weird introduction for her. She's just suddenly there. We don't find that... Yeah, we don't have that introduction. I don't know if it's ever really picked up. So she's supposed to be a computer programmer from the 1980s, which I don't think... I think that was, the character description that was handed to Bonnie Langford.
That's what you're getting.
And she's always known for screaming a lot, over the top, maybe a bit of over the top acting. It's not subtle.
But neither is the Doctor.
Well, no, I suppose you could argue that, couldn't you?
The Doctor's acting isn't that subtle. When they're together, there's quite a nice energy between them both. They sort of bounce off each other in a way, because he's this big over the top character. She is, but they're not trying to compete with each other on that. And actually, this Doctor by now, he's so settled in what this character is. Also, we've talked a lot about Dickhead Doctor. There is no sign of Dickhead Doctor in this at all. He is very comfortable and content in who he is as a character, with who he interacts with and everything.
Well, I don't know if that's supposed to show, because this is a future thing. And it's a shame he wasn't more like that with Perry. You just then see, because he's so great with Mel like that. That is the dynamic that we should have had all this time. And that's how he should have started. That scene, it sums her up a bit. That scene in the TARDIS. So he's got the Doctor. She's got the Doctor on an exercise machine.
Yeah. And there's a lot of weird exercise things throughout. The gym becomes quite a big thing. I liked you doing her aerobics. That was quite funny.
But this is this is what you get in the classic series, isn't it? Your character, you're a computer programmer, you like the gym, that's it. That's all you're going to get.
She likes aerobics and she's a computer programmer.
Yeah. And she tries to give the Doctor carrot juice. And I'll just send you a picture. This is my favourite picture, when I met Bonnie Langford and Colin Baker. We had a green screen. I'm sure you've seen it, actually. I've just sent it to you. A green screen in the TARDIS.
I've seen this one.
Yeah, and I bought the carrot juice. So now you know why I had the carrot juice there.
Now it makes sense.
And she was like, I don't actually like carrot juice. And then Colin Baker was like, but I actually do. So that was nice. So I was living my best Trial of a Time Lord moment there. The other reason I thought you would like this story, which I said last week, was it's a bit of a murder mystery. And we like
a murder mystery, me. And it's very much played into that.
It's very much that, isn't it? Somebody's on board.
Sci-fi Poirot, that's what it was.
Exactly. It's supposed to be this...
with an eccentric man trying to solve a mystery. That is exactly what it was.
So there's not many people on this ship. It's supposed to be a big cruise liner thing, I think. But there's hardly anyone on there. There's one steward, poor Janet, the steward, who has to serve everybody, who seems to be on call the whole time. She does everything. There's no other staff apart from the captain. She is doing everything there. So I'm just going to say, well done, Janet, there. Maybe a hero.
Oh, yeah, Janet
award.
There's that one point where, she said, it could be Janet. And he's sort of like, no, it's not Janet. We all know it's not Janet.
As it's unfolding, were you enjoying that sort of mystery and trying to work out who it was?
Yeah, and I liked the sort of throwbacks when we're in the... So that's why I think it worked well. We see a scene and then he goes, but that person's... he almost can you not see that? And sometimes we went back and saw things and I enjoyed all that.
Yeah, with the voice things and those aliens going back and looking at the evidence. Maybe if we'd had
that's
a bit more of that.
The court thing really fit into this story. It felt like a natural flow, not I'm going to come out and do a court scene where we have some dialogue and then we just go back into the story.
Yeah, they should have done that a bit more, sort of analysed the footage or done something like that, or made it fit more into those scenes. I think, it does work really well here. Yeah, so we've got our cast of characters. Maybe we should just talk about them and just work out that. So, Who have we got? Well, we've mentioned Janet. We love Janet. So you've got like the three scientists. So you've got Professor Lasky, who I think, because she's in the gym a lot, is this the first hoodie we've seen in Doctor Who?
Oh, mate.
Like she's wearing her tracksuit. I don't think anyone else.
I thought like hoodlum.
Yeah.
But you mean actual hoodie? Maybe.
Well, she's wearing her like a lovely sort of mauve tracksuit. And I just saw like, that she's wearing like the hoodie. And I was like, it just looks so modern in a Doctor Who story.
It's so funny because it's modern. And yet at the start, they're still given keys for their room.
Oh, yes, true.
Like,
yes.
And it's so funny. Like, it's when I watch things like that and I think, like, in the 80s, they could not predict that we would have cards to open doors in hotels or suites or whatever, you know. They're still given a key.
Yeah.
With the number with the number on it.
Yeah.
The whole 6-9 thing.
Well, talking about modern, I mean, we have to talk about the gym because it's the worst gym I have ever seen. Space gym. It's like three bits of equipment. There's like this running thing which you have to do yourself when the doctor walks on it. There's not even a button for the walker thing.
Also, let's talk about aerobics. Like the fact that they're like, put this on, you can have your aerobics. In the 80s, they believed aerobics was the future and we were all going to be doing it forever.
You've got all those little headsets. It's not like it's an aerobics class.
Whenever
it's
I think aerobics, I think of water aerobics and over 60s. So that is exactly what I think of when I think of aerobics. I never think like, oh, it's a gym class. I don't think I've ever seen, in all of my gyms, I've never seen an aerobics class. I've seen a dance class. And I've seen many other classes. I've never seen aerobics.
I mean, Bonnie Langford could take the dance class. She could teach
sure.
that.
For sure. It's so funny, that idea of like, this is the future and what we're seeing. And like you say, the gym is like there.
But it's like a holiday liner. There's like one bicycle machine and some headsets, and all aerobics is some music that
Mel with instructions, someone telling you what to do.
Swing her arms to. Do you know what's more futuristic than that gym? Your hula hooping thing. Your contraption.
Yeah.
Can you tell everyone about your hula hooping thing?
Mark loves my hula hoop. Oh, it's one of those, like, you can get, like, hula hoops, like, big ones, but this is one of those where you've got, like, the heavy ball on the end and you make it turn. I like a hula hooping.
Could you take a photo and send that so I can show everyone? Maybe you don't have to be wearing it, just take a photo of it.
No,
because
it's like a sex toy. We've had this discussion. Yeah, I will find another picture on the internet of it.
No, it's got to be yours. It looks really odd, everyone.
But it works.
But, yeah.
But then when you put it on, you're like, oh, it's a completely different thing. Like you see, you're like, what, Sarah? What is that? My friend was like, do not have that over if you have a man over. Like that's it. Or do not have that out if you've got a man over. That looks horrific. And then you put it on, and it's like, oh wait, yeah, I see it.
It's sort of like a black ball.
It's like a black belt. And yeah, you have like different connectors, and then there's a string, and on the end of it is big. Well, it's got like sand in it. It's like a heavy weight ball thing. But out, it does look like a weird sex thing.
Okay, well, we'll put a picture up of it. But they haven't got them here in this gym. The other thing about the gym is they throw away the towels.
Yeah.
Because
again, we're talking the future. In the future, we don't wash, we just dispose in an incinerator.
Because there's the bin, and it's not the laundry bin, because it's going to the incinerator, isn't it? It's like, use your towel once and put it in the incinerator. That is not on.
No. They're not thinking of the environment in the 80s.
Well, they're not thinking about the environment. They're killing all the plants.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a very, like, unfuture story.
So yeah, we've got all the who else have we got? So that was Professor Lasky. The other two scientists, a little bit boring, but it does revolve around them. So they've got this, I mean, on board they must have paid a lot of money, because it's pretty much just taking all of their stuff, isn't it, to somewhere on this ship, all of the hydroponics and everything. The sets look really good. When
all the sets look good, there's that like dining hall, and sometimes you just runs through it, but the dining hall looks quite good.
It does look like a very 80s like hotel, doesn't it? With like the lights on the side, the sort of patio furniture. They haven't really changed. They've not made it too spacey.
To me, the look Sorry, can you hear that? There's someone just banging like this constantly on the wall. I can't work out what they're doing. Anyway, to me, it looks like what in the 80s they imagined the future to be. If we're talking 40 years difference, it's not the most accurate thing. Like, when in the future is this set?
Oh, they do say, he says the year, it's like 3,000, and it's a long time.
Yeah.
It's a long, long time.
I think even like, well, maybe we're wrong, right? Because maybe in that future, like, you know how like now we say like 1920s, 30s is really decadent, right? And I have friends who've got like houses, like old houses, and they're pulling things back to get that 30s, 40s, you know, the old tiles and things like that. It's all been hidden away because like in the 70s, 80s, we didn't want to see it. So maybe we're wrong, man. Maybe in the future, I mean, we'll want all that sort of old, like an aerobics will come back.
It could be like a 80s themed cruise.
It could be.
Thing, you know, because maybe they're sort of disguising it with that. That's why they're taking the Vervoids on board. We've got a few other characters that, because people, typical, like a murder mystery, people start getting killed off one by one.
Of course, yeah.
There's that old man that gets killed.
Oh, that was sad. Vervoids. I liked him.
There's the guy that's pretending to be the alien that's not. He's like the investigator guy. That's the first clue that we get that there's something going on the, because someone recognises him and it's all a bit confusing. The security guard, I found him a bit annoying.
Yeah, he's really annoying.
But like, did you guess who it was going to be? Because there was sort of like three different things going on. There was obviously the Vervoids were doing stuff in the background. The security guard wanted to hijack and take over. And then the scientist in brown, he was the one working with the Vervoids. But then the scientist in green was the one that sort of went crazy and took over the ship as well.
I know, it was a bit hard to keep track of, to be honest. And the whole taking over thing didn't interest me. I guess in my mind, it was just the Vervoids killing people off because they wanted, and that's kind of all I was interested in.
Well, we got some good cliffhangers, because the first cliffhanger, Mel is sort of flirting with that guy, he's like, come, you know, I'll take you to the hydroponics center. And he gets electrocuted. But then this is where we get the first Mel scream.
I mean, big screams.
But she was told to scream big, and she was told to scream in the right key that fitted with the closing music.
Oh, she really? Key.
She was told to do that. I think if she had it her own way. I mean, this is strange with the criticism of her acting and stuff. Obviously, she's brilliant. Like, she's done a lot of audios and stuff as Mel much later on, and that completely changed the character and made her more of the computer programmer and the more of the character that we have seen recently on TV, and I'm sure we will see more of. It was sort of a way of trying to get away from that 80s Mel, which wasn't particularly great. But they were in one of the documentaries, she went in to do the audition apparently, and she wasn't like that. She wasn't so over the top. She was more subtle. She was doing, and then I don't know what happened. Either the producer had a word with her or something, or told. But when they started filming, everyone was a bit surprised that she was sort of acting more theatrical, because she hadn't done that in the audition and stuff. It was a bit strange. And again, we know there's a lot of behind the scenes stuff going on. No one's really keeping an eye properly. They were probably just like, it's Bonnie Langford. You see Bonnie Langford a lot of the time because she's so well known as that. You don't necessarily see Mel.
Maybe that's initially what they wanted. Maybe they wanted more Bonnie and less
I think Mel. It's more... I think, unfortunately, she is there for the publicity rather than her acting ability in the 80s. But, yeah, it's a great cliffhanger, though, with all the explosions and everything.
Just on a similar thing to that, what's interesting, if we're going to compare it, is the new Who that's coming up, and we're going to have Jinx Monsoon.
I mean, it's gone the other way, where that sort of stunt casting back then was looked down upon as a bit like, oh, this is a bit sort of light entertainment. It should, but now if they want to get guest people in, it's the same sort of idea to get people watching. But I don't know. The criticism is just, yeah, it's completely changed around. I mean, some people might complain about sort of certain names, and in the new series as well, they have done this thing where they're like, oh, this person's going to be in it, but they give them like a really rubbish scene or really, and they're not in it actually that much. People know who Bonnie Langford is for this new series, so it is part of that again. But I don't know, her acting, yeah, like, because she's been in EastEnders since, and she's done sort of more serious drama roles, I suppose. Back then, she was very much known for musicals, light entertainment stuff. I don't think she'd really... I mean, but Doctor Who, I'd have to go back and have a look, but this is probably her most serious role, if you can...
And Doctor Who isn't serious.
Know, and it isn't that serious.
It is in its own way, light entertainment.
I like how she's got so much energy, and she's invested. She takes a lot of the story on. She wants to get involved, and the Doctor doesn't for quite a lot of the time.
Like, it's weird when you say stunt casting, because it almost doesn't feel it. She's very involved. She has a lot of scenes by herself. She's investigating. Like, she's talking to people. She's very independent.
Mm. But I just think it was a bit of a clash with your typical serious Doctor Who fan, especially in the 80s, that were taking things very seriously. You can see how that would clash. But no, I do think she's great. The Vervoids. What do you think of the Vervoids?
A bit shit.
I mean, I think they're quite a clever creation.
Are you just generous there, Mark?
No, well...
You are so critical of things and the monsters and costumes.
I quite like it. I like all the leaves, like the suit with the leaves. I'd love a suit with leaves all over it.
It's the faces for me.
Okay, so the faces, right. So, two things here. I had a poster of a Vervoid, right?
Oh, there we go.
In year seven, when I first started secondary school. And in our, like, tutor room, we had, like, a little area on the wall, and everyone had to bring something in to stick on the wall and be like, yeah, we'll decorate it for our tutor group and everything, blah, blah, blah. And I brought in my Vervoid poster.
Oh, she did.
I think, so I mean, much. 97, everyone had, like, Spice Girls Boyzone pictures of Holiday, and I brought in a Vervoid.
This explains a lot.
And I remember giving it to my teacher and her sort of looking at it and being like, okay. And I did go up on the wall, but it disappeared after one day, and I never saw that again, and my teacher never mentioned it again. It just went.
Yeah.
And okay, they look a bit, and also I think the other story is, so when Doctor Who wasn't on, sort of in the 90s, early 2000s, Doctor Who magazine was still going, and I think this is true, there was a Vervoid on the front cover of Doctor Who magazine in like 2001 or 2 or something. And I think W.H. Smith's said it looked too rude.
Yeah, of course it did.
To put on the front of the... To put out on the front of the newsstands and stuff. So they don't look... Yeah, they look a bit funny, don't they?
They look a bit... 18.
18?
Rather than PG. You know?
Well, they're like a flower, aren't they?
Sure. I've told you about what my PSHE teacher called. Yeah. Should I say that story? I'm sure I've said it before.
Yeah, no, I know. Yeah.
So my PSHE teacher when I was in year seven was my art teacher, who was also my form tutor. And so we're going through, you know, we're reading the books, and she's like, oh, I don't like the word vagina. Whenever you see the word vagina, just say Lily. That sounds nicer.
There we go.
So instead of vagina, we said Lily. Does it sound
well? I mean, you could, if you're any sex education people out there, you could call them Vervoids now, or we should call the Vervoids lilies.
Lilies, they're another form of plant.
I think they're creative though, and I like how they are. They look like they're sort of grown out of the plant. It's just
they look like they're just like rude.
I don't like how they talk. They sort of whisper and you can't really hear what they're talking about. I don't think they should have talked as much.
There were some things I just didn't understand but didn't matter to me. Like, you know the woman, what was it? They said her name. She was the assistant and she has the bald head with the...
Oh, in that cliffhanger. That was really shocking.
That's a really good cliffhanger and it doesn't really go anywhere.
Well, she was one of the other assistants and she got infected.
And now, now she's like stuck and they're like freezing her out. And
because they kept taking her dinner and stuff. I don't know what they were trying to do. They were treating her like an experiment because she was zipped up in that thing. It was like, it wasn't exactly looking after her very well.
No. If
they were someone
all very odd. It was all very odd.
But it was a great moment, and the makeup and stuff for that.
Oh yeah,
was great. And I don't think poor Mel. I mean, if I woke up and I was ill, I wouldn't want Mel screaming at me the moment I open my.
Like, and what she's saying, she's something like, "Don't trust that." I can't remember what she said.
Well, she was warning about the vervoids,
right?
Because I think Professor Lasky and her guys were like intentionally trying to make these vervoids grow, these vervoids in the pods, and obviously it had gone wrong a bit with her. It's just there for an extra sort of shock moment and a bit of a, because you don't see the vervoids for quite a long time.
You don't, no.
In the background, I quite like that. I like the malaria. Oh god, what are they called? I'm gonna get told off. Malagans.
Are they the ones that had the translators?
The robot ones. Yeah.
They're all right. They're effective, yeah. Idea.
And when you saw their gold face as well, that was quite an extra cool bit. I'm just looking through my notes. I've just put Janet one steward. When does she get a break?
When does Janet get a break?
But it explains, like, in terms of the vervoids, they've got a clear intent. I like the way that the doctor's like, when you have a compost heap, you just put all the cuttings on the compost heap, and then they're just sort of getting people one by one and piling up the bodies and stuff. I've put Professor Lasky as a Fitbit because she says she's got like a heart monitor thing. They thought of Fitbits at least. It was a rubbish gym, but she's got a Fitbit on.
She was obsessed with her gym as well. She was getting really annoyed that people were disturbing her workout.
Yeah. I mean, that's all she wanted to do, just grow some vervoids and have a bit of a workout while she's on that
thing. Stop disturbing me.
Yeah. This story also, I think this is one of my favourite stories of this whole lot. I think people like this one. And on the Blu-ray, they've done a version where they cut out all the court scenes and it's just the story on its own.
I think it would work really well. Like, this was, for me, out of all we've had so far, this was the best flow.
Yeah, it just worked. It
felt
really well.
It felt natural. It didn't jump about. I mean, like I said, I didn't understand a lot. I feel like I needed to watch to follow what was going on. Like, back a lot of the detail. But it didn't affect my enjoyment of the story and following the narrative of, like, the basic narrative of what they were trying to do.
And it also helped that they've said that the Doctor and the Captain's met before, so you don't have any of that, who are you on board, are you stowaway, all of that. You cut all of that out as well, which is what we always appreciate. Like, the Captain's actually not a dickhead Captain, he's like a helpful Captain for once. So it's a good mix of characters, which you need in your Agatha Christie style thing. There's all different types of people.
It's such a different way of doing it, sort of like, it's in the future and we are in it, and there's no like here, this is where we're presenting from, follow it.
But the only other bit as well, which they address this time, which they should have done last week. So there's a bit of the Doctor smashing up the communications and he's got the axe, and then the Doctor's like, that wasn't me. So we're really clear now that somebody is changing the evidence.
So that is the other thing that works really well in this story. The narrative is really clear, and it's really clear that he knows exactly what he's meant to be doing and saying and stuff, and where his angle is. And it's all that stuff is great.
So you know that scene didn't actually happen, and it's clear for us that didn't happen. Whereas last week, that was the problem. We should have had that where we should have been clear that this, he didn't torture Perry or whatever. I liked that. And then, it fitted again. There was a reason to stop then and go into the courtroom, because that was stuff that didn't happen. Yeah, this story also reminds me of when I got the video. My aunt, well, she's not my aunt. She's my grandmother's sister's daughter. Anyway, she came up to visit,
right? Yeah.
And I got this on video, I remember, and it was like in the summertime, and everyone was sitting out in the garden.
Yeah.
And I got really bored. I think my brother got bored, and I came in to watch Terror of the Vervoids. It was like episode 3. I remember it. I had it really up, really loud, and my mum got really annoyed that we just ignored this visiting family to put on Terror of the Vervoids. And she's the one that was on the Big Breakfast that was singing.
Oh, right.
So she was on in the 90s. She was on Big Breakfast, and then, because she used to go round, she's from Liverpool, and she used to go round different like clubs and stuff and do like entertaining, like,
is she Lily Savage? I'm confused. You've never told me this story before.
She's not Lily Savage. What are you talking about?
You said in the 90s. She went around.
Yeah. In the 90s.
Went around the club entertaining people. She's so, Liverpool.
They used to go around. They used to do like the sort of cabaret circuit right. with like Ken Dodd and stuff like that all that time. And then they ended up sort of going around sort of care homes and old people's places, like singing to them and stuff. Anyway, she got. Big Breakfast were doing a singing grannies competition all right. that week. And she was asked to go on and she had to... I don't think she won, though. And I found the clip and that's what I sent to you, her doing the singing grannies competition.
I think you've sent that.
I sent the clip and you were like, there's a million things going on here and a million questions.
I say that about a lot of things you send me. That does not narrow it down.
No, because she was on there and Anton Deck were presenting.
We've got three grannies and our first up is Jan. Jan, if you like
to
stand.
Jan. Yay! Yay!
How are you feeling, Jan?
Fine. Now I had a breakfast, yeah.
So how's your singing voice this morning? You're in tune, you're ready to go?
That probably.
Sounds pretty good.
sounds very good to me.
Good luck, Gran.
Good luck, if you'd like to step up to the mic.
We're going
to
give you a big showbiz 3, 2, 1. In
3, 2, 1.
Gran!
Here we go, Gran.
We are young, we are green, keep our teeth nice and clean. See our friends, see the sights, see our eyes.
Okay, I'll send it to you again. I'll send it anyway. This reminds me, Terror of the Verfoids reminds me of her because that's when she was visiting and I ignored her and wanted to watch Terror of the Verfoids. That was a long-winded way of saying it.
That involves Anton Deck, yeah.
Yeah. So we finished the story, though. I mean, we've gone through pretty quick, but we finished...
But it all goes quite quick anyway. There's not, like, loads of intense detail in this story because the whole point, and it doesn't happen till the third episode, is he's trying to get to the point where he's like, they asked me to do this. You know, that is basically the point. And he does. And then it becomes like, well, did you get rid of them all? And he's like, yes. Well, then you eliminated a race. And now you're on. That's literally the point of that whole thing. So thankfully, it's a really fun, interesting story. But there's not a lot to talk about because there's not a lot really to it other than those moments.
Well, yeah, I was going to say about, like, the genocide accusation. The Valiard has changed his admin again. I don't think you could do this halfway through. Be like, actually. So he's been like, this is just a little inquiry. Oh, actually, no. This is actually going to condemn you now because you've interfered. We're going to put you to death. Actually, I'm going to change it now. You've created genocide, so we're going to do something even worse now.
Article 7 permits no exceptions. The Doctor has destroyed a complete species. The charge must now be genocide.
But the Inquisitor agrees this time. She's like, oh yeah, the section, I'll get my paperwork out for this one now. She's loving it. I mean, she's watched three great Doctor Who stories.
Yeah, she's having a well of a time.
It's 1, 2, 3, 4. It's like 5 Watch Who. It's us and the Inquisitor and the Valiard.
Well,
and
the jury, however many.
And the jury.
Non-jury jury. I call them the jury.
Yeah, I'm going to count how many is watching Doctor Who this time. So then we left on that cliffhanger now. But it's funny that... Oh, no, well, that's going to be spoilers. Let's just edit myself there. I can't say what else is going to happen. But we've got 2 episodes to wrap it up.
Yeah. So we'll see.
Because we still haven't really solved that mystery.
I think something will be addressed with Perry. I wonder, because it's the 80s and it's been a while, and this is a pure, like, guess. I don't have any idea if, like, the Master's been messing with the Matrix or something. We haven't had the Master for a while. Just saying.
Well, we had him last season.
Yeah, that's a while in, like, Doctor Who verse. Love bringing back people that we know. It feels like it's someone that we know that's been messing with it, but I don't know who.
Okay. I mean, you can tell it's the 80s a lot because when Bonnie Langford and Con Baker are together on camera, there is a lot of curls and a lot of hair going on.
Oh, yeah. And a lot of lycra. She's wearing so much lycra.
She's got, like, clothes watch. She's got a good outfit. And the Doctor's got a new waistcoat and a bow.
Yeah.
To show it's the future.
Still the same coat, but...
I like this style, the sort of lighter style. We love a mystery. Mel is divisive, but... I don't mind her. At least that's a bit of energy. It's completely different to Perry. They have gone for someone completely
different. Yeah, it's a completely different energy, and it kind of just like refreshes it in a way that whether you like her character or not, it's such a different energy and to it. Yeah.
Because if you think about it, Mel is the first one that really wants to be there properly for a long time. Because Perry did, but she had a lot
she
of
always wanted
to
go back to the TARDIS. Yeah.
But Mel's like, there's a distress signal. We've got to go. We've answered your distress signal. We need to work this out. Mel is like, I want to be here and I want to do this.
And she's been, it feels like she's been there a while. It feels like she's been there. She knows how these things work. She knows what they do.
Well, this isn't really spoilers, but it's interesting to mention. She doesn't get an introductory story. This is it.
Oh, I can imagine. Never, yeah.
They don't go back and they don't like film her. This is like, that is it. So it's just really odd.
It's a really odd introduction, but it does sort of work in terms of where we are in the storyline of things.
Yeah.
I didn't expect it, and that's also quite fun.
Okay, well, we've only got two episodes left, and that's called The Ultimate Foe.
Oh, there we go. It will conclude.
I'll talk about it next week, but I'll just sort of mention now. So this is where it's really going bad behind the scenes. So the script editor walks out.
Right.
And I think by the end of Terror of the Vervoids, he's walked out. Because the guy that was supposed to write the last two episodes, who did the first two, he died.
Right.
And then the script editor was supposed to finish the last two, but he's not getting on with the producer. And they finally just like, he's like, I'm gone. You're not using my script. I'm fed up of this. So now the producer has to find someone to write the last two episodes and explain everything and wrap it up.
I meant to ask, that story was written by, it said something and something Baker?
Pip and Jane Baker.
Yeah. Who are they?
They're a married couple.
Yeah.
Pip and Jane. They're a lovely couple. They wrote the Rani one. They invented the Rani.
Oh, really? That's interesting. I never really paid much attention to that, but it just popped up, and I think with the name Baker as well, I was like, I wonder. Anyway, yeah.
But then, so the producer, actually, they finish off, they write the next two as well, because they just had to go with, like, a basic, what was sort of planned, but they weren't allowed to see any of the other scripts because of, like, you couldn't steal someone else's work or whatever. So they had to be. So the producer was like, these things need to happen. You need to wrap it all up and explain it all. So good luck, everybody. So it's all going on at behind the scenes. And this Eric Saywood, the script editor, who's been there for a long time, he left. He did this magazine interview being like, I don't agree the way Doctor Who's run. I think it's terrible. Just all this horrible stuff. He's saying he didn't think Colin Baker should be the Doctor. It was a really bad casting choice. All this stuff just came out, which upset the producer, upset Colin Baker, because Colin Baker was like, well, we were friends. I went round his house for dinner and stuff. And then suddenly he just comes out. It just all just was like, probably not like massive news, but within that, the Doctor Who realm and within the production team, and then fans sort of found out because he did this magazine interview. So Colin Baker and Eric Saywood has never been sort of, I don't think they've been at the same convention. They've not been on the same panel. They have to avoid each other here because it was pretty awful.
Oh yeah, yeah.
Said
no one wants to, even if, especially when you're doing a job, you cannot think they're the best casting choice, but you don't say it while someone's in the job and doing it, especially that long in. You can say, like, you know, with the way the character's gone, like, I didn't agree with. But it seems weird to have, like, criticised, like, I don't think they were the right person and I don't like them doing it.
But this is with Eric Saywood. He was writing some of the scripts and he was the script editor in charge of sorting out the character and developing it and stuff. And ever since then, he's always sort of blamed everyone else. It's like, well, you're the script editor. You could, all that stuff with the Doctor and Perry and their relationship, you could have sorted that out.
Yeah,
you could have done all, you know, that was your job, and he's just like, oh, it's the producer or Colin, you know, Colin Baker, or, you know, it was just, yeah, he's, I don't know, he's a very
difficult time.
Okay, well, we'll leave it there. We'll have another recess, everyone. That was a successful third installment of Trial of a Time Lord. Is it your favorite so far?
Yeah, my criticisms are so much lower on this compared to the last one because of how it's structured together. It's really well done. And I don't know if that's like the writers or whether that's the director making choices of like how things flow and overlap.
Yeah, he's a good director. He's done a few others before. Do you know what? I think he went to... I think he produced Skins eventually.
Okay.
The director of this.
Well, there we go.
He did quite a few good. He's still working, I think.
Yeah.
Doing quite a few things.
Because even that, like how it overlapped at the start, it made it feel like we're in one story. And I noticed that, and I was like, it just felt like it's natural flow. And obviously, we're going into someone we don't even know. We don't know Mel and the Doctor. Like they don't know their relationship or anything.
I think what they could have done. With all those court scenes throughout, is if they've had a break or something in it, had some scenes sort of elsewhere in that station, like I don't know, the Doctor talking to someone or trying to find out, or when he's trying to, do you know what I mean? You could have had other characters around that, or some of the Time Lords talking, being like, oh, this is going on, or the Doctor trying to get help or something. It's just because that's quite static back and forth. You don't go anywhere else, and no one else talks. They could have maybe been a bit more creative, I think, but I don't know, budget and.
Yeah.
All that kind of stuff. But anyway, okay, we'll see how it all wraps up next week. So we will see you all then for The Ultimate Foe.
Yeah.
In the meantime, you can follow us on Twitter and Instagram at TwoWatchWho, or support us at buymeacoffee.com/TwoWatchWho. So, court adjourned. Bye.
Bye.
TwoWatchWho.